So in this video segment, I'm going to talk about what's called the multiplier effect. And let's go ahead and imagine a scenario that goes something like this. The government decides to spend $96 billion more than people thought. How much does this affect aggregate demand? Well, at the very least, this causes government spending G to go up by $96 billion. But remember, that government spending is income to someone. So let's suppose the government decides to spend this much on, you know, building a new highway from, you know, Chicago to Seattle. So a bunch of contractors get paid, and the workers, and so on and so forth, and the people who made the asphalt, and, you know, all the people in the supply chain to supply those goods get paid. So there's $96 billion extra income for the suppliers and workers. And typically, we see that when people get extra income, they spend that income. Maybe not all of it, maybe some of it. Suppose, on average, the what we call marginal propensity to consume is 75%, which of course is the same as 3/4. So the marginal propensity to consume is, if you got one extra dollar of income, what would be your likelihood or propensity? So marginal means extra, right? Propensity means likelihood. What amount would you increase your consumption spending by? And we're saying here that, you know, we're just picking a number to make the example work, but that people would raise their consumption spending by 75 cents for every dollar of income that they get. So when people have $96 billion of extra income, we get an increase in consumption spending of 96 × 3/4, and that should be $64 billion. And so now we have aggregate demand rising by 96 billion plus an extra 64 billion. But this $64 billion worth of consumption spending is income to someone. So people at retail stores and the suppliers of the goods and so on and so forth out there. And they are going to go ahead and increase their consumption spending by whatever 3/4 of 64 is, and that's 48. And then that is income to someone else out there, and they're going to increase their consumption spending by 3/4 of 48, which is, I think, 36, and so on and so forth down the line. So the overall increase in aggregate demand is 96 plus 64 plus 48 plus 36, and so on down the line. The mathematics of this sort of get into infinite series and so on and so forth, so I'll ask you to trust me on the following point, that at the end of this whole process, the overall increase in aggregate demand is going to be 1 over the marginal propensity to consume, 1 over 1 minus the marginal propensity to consume, times the change in government spending. So, in our particular case, It's 1 over 1 minus 3 quarters times 96, which is 1 over 1 quarter times 96, which is 4 times 96, or what is this, 384 maybe? Okay, so double check that on your calculator. I think that's right. So the overall increase in aggregate demand is about 384. So if we were drawing this, what we'd say here is this much might be the increase in G. So initially you might think that the aggregate demand curve would shift left by the amount of the increase in G, but it actually shifts, sorry, not left, right. I swear I do know the difference between my left and my right. So it would actually increase not by 96, but by 384. So that's the overall idea of the multiplier effect. Now, one thing to notice is the multiplier effect doesn't just apply to changes in government spending. It applies to any change in spending out there in the economy. So in particular, let's suppose that we have a real estate market crash and we have a decrease in residential construction spending of $360 billion. How much does aggregate demand decrease? Well, it doesn't decrease by just $360 billion, because when there's $360 billion less construction spending, a bunch of income is lost for construction workers and building suppliers and so on and so forth. And then they spend less, and then that lowers the income for people who, you know, would have sold them, sweat socks and so on and so forth out there. And then that lowers someone else's income and so on and so forth out there. So, a high multiplier means aggregate demand is very sensitive to changes in spending. And a low multiplier means aggregate demand is insensitive. So often when students first see a discussion of the multiplier, they think, oh, a high multiplier is good, because that means with a relatively small amount of change of spending, the government can move aggregate demand by a lot, so that's going to go ahead and be a good thing. It'll be easy to use fiscal policy to get aggregate demand where we want. But it's also true that a high multiplier means aggregate demand is very unstable. You know, we sort of say if someone's sensitive, someone's a very sensitive personality, that can be kind of a double-edged compliment, right? It can mean that they're very perceptive, or it can mean that they're sort of emotionally unstable. A low multiplier means aggregate demand is insensitive, or we could also say it's very stable. Now, what does the multiplier actually look like in our economy? The simple multiplier I gave earlier is too simple. A more realistic multiplier would take account of at least two additional facts. So first, not all increases in income are available to spend because, say for instance, people pay taxes. So when you have a higher income, you know, not all of that $64 billion is available for you to spend because you pay taxes on that income. Second, what we would see here is some income is spent on imports. So it kind of leaks out of the system. So let's go ahead and call little t is our tax rate as a decimal. So that is, we're going to think, say for instance, maybe in the United States, the average tax rate is 0.025, so 25% on average. And let's think about what we call our marginal propensity to import. Which is the idea of, if you have $1 of extra spending, how much of that is spent on imports? And let's call that 10%. So if we do all that, our formula for the multiplier, our more realistic formula for the multiplier, ends up being a kind of ugly fraction, 1 minus our marginal propensity to consume times 1 minus our tax rate t plus our marginal propensity to import m. And if you plug these in with a sort of real world estimate of what the marginal propensity to consume in the US is, which is about 85%, then a more realistic multiplier for the US is somewhere around 2.16. And even this is sort of probably a best case scenario, because there's some other things that are more complicated to go into here. But this is probably max possible multiplier for US. So roughly speaking, if we increase government spending by $1, well, we increase aggregate demand by $1 times 2.16. So of that, $1 was an increase in government spending, and 1.16 is going to be an increase in consumption spending.